So thank you very much, Philip, for the introduction. And it is my great pleasure to give the opening keynote of our CASUS annual workshop 2029 on digital twins of complex systems. So my name is Attila Cangi. I'm the acting research team leader of the research area Matter Under Extreme Conditions at the Center for Advanced Systems Understanding. And on that note, I would also like to welcome you all. So let me start by going quickly through the agenda of my presentation. I'd like to say also a few very brief introductory words about the center and talk about the mission and the research areas related to the theme of this workshop. Then I will briefly define the key concepts that are the eponyms of this year's workshop, namely digital twins and complex systems, and thereby I'd like to provide an overview of the upcoming topics and talks in this workshop. After that, I will describe our ongoing efforts in working towards digital twins of matter under extreme conditions. And in the course of this, I'd like to describe a particular aspect and challenge in digital twins, namely multi-scale and surrogate modeling. And here I will present the materials learning algorithms framework we develop. So as you have heard in the opening speech of this workshop by Professor Saubrey, the Center for Advanced Systems Understanding is a research center located in Görlitz, Germany at the border to Poland. And CASUS combines methods from mathematics, systems theory, data science, and scientific computing at a single location in order to pursue data-driven and data-intensive systems research. So our mission is to develop digital solutions that are used across disciplines. And the other key aspect of CASUS is that the concept of open science is central to our mission, which means that most of the software solutions we develop are open source. Now, the idea behind CASUS or our center is not just carrying out domain-specific research in the individual research areas. But furthermore, the goal of CASUS as a research institute is to enable knowledge transfer beyond research domains and to enrich the other research areas. So as you see on this diagram here, seemingly different research areas, which are part of CASUS, such as matter under extreme conditions, systems biology, or system science, autonomous vehicles, and digital health. These are actually connected in an intricate fashion. And by forming cross-disciplinary research teams, we develop digital solutions that can be used across those individual disciplines and that advance fundamental science, for example, in terms of research and matter under extreme conditions, that create impact in industry and benefit society. So now coming to digital twins and complex systems. So let me attempt to define some of the key concepts. So first of all, how can we characterize digital twins? And a concise definition could be a digital twin is a comprehensive, high-fidelity digital representation of all physical processes within a complex system. And when coupled to data-driven and machine learning methodologies, a digital twin enables monitoring, diagnostics, and predictions of the complex system. So what are the key aspects and potential challenges we shall consider when we turn this abstract concept of digital twins into numerical practice? So a numerical implementation of a digital twin is a challenging process, and we'll hear about this in the course of this workshop, because it is supposed to be a realistic and dynamical digital representation of a complex system describing a realistic phenomenon. It should be connected to experimental measurements with simulation data. Likewise, it should unite phenomena from different scientific domains and enable interactive analysis. So in that sense, we can think of a digital twin as a multi-scale model, but a very advanced multi-scale model. So by breaking down this definition, we can reveal the following aspects. So when we look at a digital twin is comprehensive means that we need a common mathematical model that underpins the digital twin. Then it's a representation of physical processes. This means that we will obtain input from different sources, such as experimental measurements or simulation data. Continuing, we deal with complex systems. And this means we need to deal with phenomena that are either partitioned into subsystems or that occur on multiple length and time scales. Then there is the keyword data-driven. And this implies that we need to deal with large data volumes, which need to be processed in real time. So there'll be a high volume data streaming needed. Furthermore, machine learning methodologies. This means we need to develop and utilize surrogate models for rapid inference. And finally, the digital twin enables monitoring, diagnostics, and predictions. This implies that we need workflows that enable interactive and accessible analysis and visualization. Let me here point out our panel discussion. This will take place on Wednesday in the afternoon at 15:25, which will deal with this topic in a larger context. Now that we have a working definition of digital twins, let us look into complex systems. So we can think of a complex system as being composed of a collection of isolated units which may interact with each other. So what does complex mean in this context? So complex means that these systems exhibit emergent behavior. These systems might be nonlinear or chaotic and computationally intractable. So if you look at these terms a bit closer, what do we mean with them? With emergent, we mean that certain system properties emerge from the interactions and the network structure of the isolated components. Nonlinear or chaotic implies that complex systems may respond in different ways to the same input. And with networked, we mean that the individual building blocks are connected and interrelated. And these connections might also be non-trivial. Now, this definition is very abstract. Therefore, let us have a look at this little animation, which I believe can give us some intuition. So when we look at this image here at the system as a whole, we see a collective wave-like motion. In this case, it's a result of an optical illusion. You see a wave traveling from the lower right to the upper left corner. But when we now zoom into a single component of the system, for example here, we can only observe a circular motion. And without knowledge of how the individual components are connected, how they are oriented in space in this case, we would not be able to predict the overall collective oscillations that we observe in the system as a whole. So admittedly, this is a very simplistic example, and it lacks some of the other properties in the definition of complex systems, but I think it still gives us a good picture and conveys the concept of a complex system in a very intuitive fashion. Now, as we're talking about complex systems, we should also recall that the Nobel Prize this year was awarded for complex systems, and I'm quoting, it was awarded for groundbreaking contributions to the understanding of complex systems. And then continues, and one of the prizes, one of the themes was for the physical modeling of Earth's climate, and so on and so forth. So one of the most obvious complex system is Earth's climate and climate models as a digital representation of that. And there are ongoing efforts to create digital twins of Earth's climate system. And we'll have a talk on this in the course of this workshop. And these efforts go towards ever increasing resolution. And this is needed in response to the challenges of climate change we are facing. And this example shown here is one of these efforts, which is this Earth 2 effort you might have seen, which NVIDIA is leading and which has been revealed just a few weeks ago. So, however, complex systems come in a number of manifestations. And in our workshop this week, we will get to see and discuss various complex systems and their digital twins across research domains. For example, digital energy systems. So Giovanni De Carne will present a digital twin workflow for dealing with energy management problems in particle accelerator facilities. Similarly, in the energy grid problem on the larger scale, which is highly relevant to the upcoming energy transition in Germany and other countries, will be addressed by Veit Hagenmeier's presentation. Biological systems are another example of complex systems. So Felix Schirmann will address the topic of modeling brain tissue in terms of a data-driven computational framework. It enables studying the complex nature of the brain and linking brain signals to healthy and diseased states. And Marino Cerial will present digital models of liver tissue. These models elucidate how the complex three-dimensional tissue architecture forms from smaller molecular components. These models thereby enable understanding the relationship between tissue organization and pathogenic mechanisms. Continuing and related, but on larger scales, we'll have three talks which focus on digital health. So Jaroslav Hareschlag will present a functional data analytic approach to investigate the influence of head impact exposure on sport-related concussions. Thomas Neumuth will talk about his work on developing digital twins of patients to achieve personalized model-based medicine. On a similar note, Tjalf Thiemsen will present the concept of pairing digital twins with characteristics of individual patient data to achieve individualized disease management for the use case of multiple sclerosis. And the last set of speakers can be grouped under the common term of digital diagnostics. So in this presentation, Frank Dressel will deal with the general question of how we can trust digital twins beyond just considering them as black box models. Olga Fink will address the question of fault diagnostics in complex systems by fusing physics-based algorithms with deep neural networks. And finally, Neil Sveti will present digital twins of the Earth system to model, monitor, and simulate natural phenomena and related human activities. So this was examples of different complex systems and their digital twins we will encounter in the course of this workshop. In the remainder of the talk, I'd like to look into our efforts towards digital twins of matter under extreme conditions. And when we talk about matter under extreme conditions, what do we mean? So here we refer to phenomena that are induced by strong electromagnetic fields, high temperatures and pressures. On a fundamental science level, probing and simulating extreme conditions is essential for understanding astrophysical objects, such as the interiors of planets and stars. But also in terms of material science, this research area propels the discovery of unexplored materials properties. For example, the walls of fusion reactors shown here, they're exposed to harsh conditions, and understanding effects such as helium bubble formation in these reactor walls is a key challenge and has a great impact on finding materials with new properties. For example, materials that are, in this case, more stable against radiation. Lastly, this research area also has impact on a technological or from a technological point of view. Extreme conditions occur, for example, in the heating process of inertial fusion confinement capsules on their pathway towards ignition. Understanding this process is another key challenge and is unsolved at this moment. And equally important, and this is shown here in the lower plot, is the diagnostics of high energy density experiments. These rely on a strong interplay with simulations. These experiments are conducted in large-scale facilities around the globe, For example, at one of our partner institutions at the Hyper facility, which is located at the European XFL in Hamburg. So I'd like to highlight some ambitious goals in terms of digital twins for meta and extreme conditions. One ambitious goal is to build digital twins of these large scale experiments, for example, of X-ray scattering experiments that are, for example, conducted at the European X-ray free electron laser facility I just mentioned. And for example, the SIMAX platform here is one such pioneering effort of creating digital twins. All aspects of a typical experiment here, such as the photon source, the light transport through all optics elements in the beamline, interactions with a target or a sample, and the scattering processes from those targets to photon detection and data analysis can be modeled in this platform. And each component here of the experiment is implemented as an HPC simulation. And these individual components are coupled to enable comprehensive simulations. That's one pioneering effort. Another interesting use case are digital twins of planetary interiors, which I'd like to focus on in the remainder of this talk. And these would give us the ability to better understand planetary formation processes. They would also allow us to connect the elemental composition of planets with their properties. And those properties are, for example, their age, their luminosity, or the magnetic fields produced. And these digital twins would also support the search for exoplanets. The experimental data, again, comes from the large X-ray facilities. And modeling is the other component. So I'd like to return to the sketch that I had shown before, which shows the key aspects of digital twins. I'd like to highlight some of the ongoing work at CASUS and our partners, which we are already either already using or plan to use to tackle some of these challenges shown on this plot. So first of all, we collect experimental data by actively collaborating with large-scale experimental facilities. I've already mentioned the European XFL, to mention one of them. Simulation data is generated by running simulations, in our case, first principles simulations on HPC systems. And a key aspect here is performance portability. We'd like to be able to run these codes on different types of architecture. It might be CPUs, GPUs, a mixture, and so on. So performance portability is important, and this is dealt with the Alpaca and Llama libraries, which are developed by CASUS researchers. Then the surrogate modeling aspects are directly addressed by us. So the materials learning algorithms package is such a surrogate model, and I will come to that one later. And this one is complemented by our collaborators at the Institute of Radiation Physics at the HZDR, who developed the neural solvers framework, which is an implementation of physics-informed neural networks to solve or invert differential equations efficiently. The aspects regarding data analysis and visualization are tackled by other CASUS scientists and collaborators we can draw on. For example, Scenery is a free and open source virtual reality visualization framework. And ISAC is a framework for in situ visualization of simulations or other high rate data sources, which runs distributed on modern HPC systems. Then high volume data streaming is important, and it can be handled with the open PMD framework, which is co-developed by CASUS scientists. So it is a standard for particle mesh data files, and in that sense, highly useful for several of our simulations. And currently, the multi-scale simulations we run are large-scale molecular dynamics simulations. These can be up to millions of atoms, which are augmented with machine learning. And the engine that drives this is the LAMMPS code. And finally, in terms of common mathematical models, we can take advantage of a particular multidimensional interpolation technique, which is bundled up in this MinterPy package. And this is also developed in a young investigator group here at CASUS. So now in the following, I'd like to focus on three aspects. I'd like to address these aspects, namely data input, multiscale simulations, and surrogate models in the context of matter under extreme conditions. So first of all, modeling matter under extreme conditions is highly challenging because we need to take into account electronic quantum effects, Coulomb correlation effects, finite temperatures, and non-equilibrium physics. All of these requires us to take into account the physics across various length and timescales, which I plot here. And then on the y-axis, I plot computational cost and accuracy. So now, on the one hand, we have device-scale simulations, and these could be particle and cell simulations or computational fluid dynamics simulations, and these operate on macroscopic scales and have proven to be very useful. However, they address these quantum effects I mentioned earlier insufficiently. On the other hand, electronic structure methods such as quantum Monte Carlo or a method called density functional theory capture these quantum effects accurately, but the computational cost of these methods limits them to macroscopic scales. So bridging these length and time scales is our goal, and we tackle this challenge with a number of methods. And these methods include strong field QED, quantum Monte Carlo and density functional theory, but also coarse-grained or reduced models. These are average atom models, quantum hydrodynamics and orbital free DFT, as well as large-scale molecular dynamics techniques at this point. And our research objectives are to both develop these individual methods and to fuse them with data-driven and physics-informed machine learning methods in order to construct multi-scale modeling workflows. So let us set the stage by defining the problem we need to solve. And let me guide you through the slide. So the electronic structure problem deals with electrons and ions that are coupled through each other through the Coulombic interaction. And this problem is represented in terms of the Schrödinger equation here. And it's a very complicated problem to solve, both conceptually and computationally. Typically, we decouple the electrons from the ions by invoking the so-called Born-Oppenheimer approximation. But even when we do this, solving the Schrödinger equation now only for the electrons is still computationally intractable. And in almost all cases, except for a few small electron problems, it's not doable. And now, as we are talking about matter under extreme conditions, we also need to take temperature into account. This means we have to go towards quantum statistical mechanics, and this makes things even more complicated. In general, the reason for the complications are the correlations among the electrons, which leads to an exponential scaling of the computational cost of solving these equations. Now, nevertheless, we have models available to run material science problems and simulations. And the state-of-the-art method that makes this problem tractable invokes a few further approximations. So first, the ions are treated as classical point particles, and the electrons are treated still in a quantum mechanical manner, but using a method that invokes some additional approximations called density functional theory. And a typical dynamical simulation is depicted here. So in a typical simulation, a reduced form of the Schrödinger equation is solved for the electronic structure, so the electronic problem. And this provides us the forces that act on the atoms. The atoms are then time evolved, leading to a new to new atomic positions, which means we have to compute a new electronic structure. And then in this way, in this cycle, this dynamical simulation is done. Nevertheless, the computational cost scales with the cube here, instead of exponential, with the cube of the particle number. This is okay, but this means that even with the most advanced HPC platforms, these simulations are very expensive and we can only deal with at most 1,000 atoms. So now, despite the cubic scaling, DFT is a very useful method. And as the left plot shows here, it is the most popular method for computing properties of materials. So the plot basically shows the number of kilopapers citing DFT methods, and this keeps growing. And therefore, this is also one of the largest computational expenses on academic HPC platforms. So most of material science here, chemistry, and some parts of physics are DFT simulations. It is therefore highly beneficial to construct machine learning surrogate models to accelerate these DFT calculations. So before we go into the details, let's have a look on the field as a whole. So I've recently put together a review article that summarizes the current state of the art in fusing machine learning with material science or electronic structure theory. And this field has been fueled by the advent of machine learning methods and by their further developments. And this is a field of that is rapidly growing. So most work, as we have found by analyzing all the papers we could find from 2013 until now, most work is on classical machine learning. So the blue category here, which means where input and output properties are just mapped. The second and also significant category is the field of developing interatomic potentials for large-scale molecular dynamics simulations. However, what we focus on is the green category here, and this is where we use machine learning to tackle directly the problem of electronic structure theory. And another interesting outcome of this analysis was that this field completely lacks models based on physics-informed neural networks. So now I'd like to come to the final topic of this talk, which is the materials learning algorithms. So to accelerate these electronic structure calculations and on the road to achieving multi-scale workflows, we have recently developed a machine learning framework based on neural networks called the materials learning algorithms. It is a Python-based code written in a modular fashion and developed fully open source. So we performed the development of the code openly on GitHub. And this code replaces traditional DFT calculations for materials at a given temperature and pressure. This has actually grown into a larger endeavor with various people here at CASUS and the HZDR contributing, as well as various other collaborators across the world. So let me walk you through some of the results. So as an example, we consider aluminum at its melting point, and the melting point of aluminum is around 933 Kelvin. And at the melting point, aluminum occurs then in two structures. One is a solid phase, close to its crystal structure, and the other is a liquid phase. So it's a disordered, so the atoms are disordered from their crystal positions. And now we have trained this materials learning algorithms, our machine learning model, on both types of atomic snapshots. And here on these plots, we illustrate how the machine learning model predicts, and the predictions are the red curves, very accurately the output of a standard electronic structure calculation. And here the quantity is the density of states. Density of states is a quantity that represents the available electronic states that the electrons can occupy. And as you can see in both solid and liquid phases, the model performs extremely well. You almost can't tell a difference between the target and the predictions. Next, the next quantity, which is very important, is the electronic density. So the electronic density tells us basically the probability to find electrons in certain volumes of space. And this is plotted here, again, for both liquid and solid structures. And here we plot the predicted values versus the target values. So each data point is the predicted density at a given grid point of the simulation. And if the results line up on a diagonal, it means that the model performs very well. And as we can see, it does. And you see a somewhat larger spread in the results for the liquid snapshots, which was expected, as the liquid snapshots are more disordered. The machine learning model can struggle a bit more, but actually, nevertheless, the accuracy is very high, as we will see on the next slide, which assesses the total energy. And the total energy is a central quantity from which we can basically derive a number of materials properties. Basically, anything interesting we can compute from a total energy by taking difference of energies or derivatives of energies. And here we basically confirm that our machine learning model works with high accuracy across the melting point for a given material for both solid and liquid snapshots. And as a bottom line, our machine learning framework is suitable as a surrogate model to replace traditional electronic structure methods. Now let's come to the issue of the computational cost and extrapolation of machine learning models. So I'm switching now to some ongoing work. So when in modeling with neural networks, there's a plethora of possible network architectures to choose from. So how do you choose the right network? One option is to just perform a search over many different network architectures and types. But a comprehensive search over network architectures is often prohibitively expensive. So hence, an efficient search would be highly desirable. And here, we recently implemented a specific method called Network Architecture Search Without Training, NASWAT. And this method provides a ranking score of untrained neural networks based on correlations in their linear maps. And this ranking score, we have seen, correlates well with the training loss. And hence, this can be used to rapidly skim through a large number of candidate networks. So here, what is plotted basically are different methods, traditional grid search, this new method, NASWAT, Optuna, and so on, orthogonal area tuning, for hyperparameter optimization. And on the y-axis, we plot the accuracy for a given network type, network architecture. And we see that actually all of them are quite accurate. So here in our case, we measure the error with respect to millielectron volts per atom, and anything below 10, we consider accurate. And let's say the standard method, a good method is using this Optuna library, which performs systematic search over network architectures, but it's quite time consuming. So here to finally end up with this result, we had to run on 12 cores for 48 hours. But this new method only took 2 hours on one core and basically provides the same accuracy. So this is some very encouraging results, and we are actually now continuing along these lines. And this is probably a very viable option to perform accurate or comprehensive searches over network architectures. Another ongoing project deals with the question of going to larger scales. So I called it extrapolation through interpolation. And what is behind this is the following. So there is this principle called nearsightedness in electronic structures. And based on this principle, or we take advantage of this principle in terms of our grid-based machine learning model to perform inference on larger systems than trained on. And as long as the training data captures the characteristic length scale of the electronic structure, we can actually obtain accurate machine learning predictions at larger numbers than we trained on. So for example, have a look at this here. The blue curve here, here is the number of atoms, and on the y-axis, the accuracy, again, of the model in millielectron volts per atom. And the blue one is here when we train the model on 256 atoms and then perform inference at higher numbers. So you have very hard, we have hard numbers for up to roughly 1,000 atoms, and you see the accuracy is quite high. But we have some, we have also preliminary results for 100,000 atoms. So nothing prevents us from just generating larger snapshots and just running inference on our machine learning model trained on small numbers. And basically we see that these results are very reasonable. And these were actually the largest DFT calculations ever performed using machine learning. And we believe this will allow us to perform large-scale simulations in a multi-scale fashion by coupling our machine learning framework to molecular dynamics simulations. So this is the road to multi-scale we hope we could be taking. And now let me come to a final aspect, namely electron dynamics. So electron dynamics simulations are needed to compute electronic transport properties or electronic response properties, such as the electrical conductivity or the thermal conductivity of materials. And these are measured in, again, in these large X-ray facilities, in X-ray scattering experiments. And these are important or relevant because these transport properties are intricately related to the geophysical dynamics in planets that take place in the interior, for example, of the Earth. So most prominently, the heat flux between the planetary core and the mantle in the Earth's core drives the dynamo action that generates the magnetic field of the Earth. Furthermore, the cooling rate here at the core mantle boundary is also used to estimate the age of our planet. And the same is true for other planets in the solar system or exoplanets. So Earth's core consists primarily of iron. And so I'm showing here the phase diagram of iron and basically look at these black crosses and mainly the red star symbols. So as we heat up iron, right, you see that it becomes liquid. It crosses the melting point and becomes liquid. However, the melting point shifts to higher temperatures as we increase the pressure. And you see basically the line delineating solid and liquid phases here. And in this manner, we can understand that the Earth has a solid inner core because there's higher pressure and a liquid outer core. And there's actually currently still an unresolved puzzle concerning the electrical and thermal conductivity in Earth's core, which is very nicely summarized in this paper here. And this issue basically stresses the need for advanced modeling techniques that can help resolve these kinds of problems. And regarding this, the aspect of electron dynamics, we actually plan to utilize physics-informed neural networks to solve the time-dependent analog of the electronic structure equations. These are shown here. These are the time-dependent Kunshan equations, which can be understood as Helmholtz differential equations, but with a non-local operator. And it is actually even more costly to solve these equations. And therefore, however, once we solve these equations, we can basically simulate the microscopic formulation of Ohm's law. And from this, we can actually compute the desired transport properties, like the electrical conductivity or the thermal conductivity for modeling of planetary interiors. And so an efficient method to find solutions of those types of differential equations are very desired, highly desired. And here you see some preliminary results. This is just a prototypical model. It's a three-dimensional harmonic quantum harmonic oscillator. And what you see here are the solutions. You see the real, these are complex solutions, the wave functions, the real and the imaginary parts and how they evolve in time. And because it's a model problem, you see actually these are like pure eigenstates, the time evolve. So they have a period of repetition. And what you see here on the right plot is actually the quantity we're interested in, which is the electronic density itself. And the next steps are basically to extend this framework and apply it to materials under external electromagnetic perturbations. And with this, I would actually like to come to the end of my presentation. I deliberately do not want to provide a summary, as I would like to open the stage for the upcoming talks and the discussions ahead of us in this workshop. I'd like to finish by thanking all my team members of the Matter Under Extreme Conditions group and our collaborators at CASUS, at the HZDR, and at the various US universities and US and French national labs. And with this, I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Attila, for this really nice talk. We still have some time until actually the next talk. So if there would be any question to the talk of Attila Cangi, we are open to take these questions rather than to wait until, 15 minutes until the next talk. So if there are any questions, please raise your hand and we can discuss this. Of course, you can also just go into the discussion and ask your question. Yes, Michael Bosman.
Thank you very much, Attila, for this wonderful talk. So you already mentioned the time dependence that you will be taking into account. Is there any disadvantage using physics-informed neural networks if you're going full time dependent? So how about the amount of learning you will actually need to take into account to do this?
Yes, this is a very good question. And it's basically something that is open and we don't know the answer to it. So I've just pulled up the slide on this again here. And so what you see here, actually, so one difficulty could be that right here is a J, an index J. So we actually have to, it labels the number of electrons and we're interested in large systems. So we have to basically perform, or we have to use physics-informed neural networks, not just for one of the solutions, but for many. This is maybe a technical or conceptual issue that has to be taken into account. And furthermore, the difficulty will be here in this parameter here. So this capital R underscore parametrizes the atomic positions. And for physics and formal neural networks to be efficient here and effective, they need to be able to learn the dependence on this parameter. That's an open question. So in the harmonic oscillator, it's example, it's a simple parameter. It's the, let's say, the frequency of the harmonic oscillator. It's just a single scalar parameter. Whereas here, this is a vector quantity, which can have a very large dimension. So this is, but we have seen it already in the MALA framework. That's the same parameter that this works. So in that sense, I have hope, or I believe there's some evidence that this is reasonable, but the networks might be large. So this is something we are very curious to explore.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yes, Michael Hecht, please go ahead.
Hi, Attila. So thanks for the talk. Just have a question for this extrapolation issue you have inside. So, I mean, have you any estimate how long you can really trust on that? I mean, so you showed that depending on how many atoms you take into the training, the accuracy of the extrapolation is better or worse. But I mean, is there any theoretical bound you can give for any estimate on how much you can trust this extrapolation prediction?
Yes. Yeah. Thanks for the question. So what I'm showing the plot here again. So basically, what I'm showing here is our actual benchmarks. So we could run, actually there's some data maybe even at 2000 atoms, but this is really the limit of how far we can generate reference data. So here we generated reference data, that's data from density functional theory calculations, but we had to really push to the limit of the HPC systems. Can't go beyond 1000 or 2000 atoms. It's not just runtime, it's also memory issues. Basically everything is starting to break down at this point. But here we got hard numbers and you see that actually it's accurate. I mean, we trained on, the train data included 256 atoms, and at around 1000 atoms, the error didn't really increase much. This is a few data points. We'll actually do more benchmarks to get a better idea of how we can extrapolate. But actually, we have run calculations, inference on 100,000 atoms. Of course, there's no way we can have reference data for this. However, we can rely on experimental data. So if we think about a particular physical phenomenon that we want to model, and we capture that phenomenon with extrapolated data, then we know it works, basically. So at the large numbers, only experiment is our place to go.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you. Are there any other questions to Attila Cangi? Yes, Michael Busman, please go ahead.
I have one more question to you, Attila. So you remember that this morning we already had our internal machine learning workshop at HZDR. And today we're again talking a lot about the role of machine learning here. One of the interesting things you're currently doing is trying to build up a multi-scale framework that allows you to go from first principles to full materials properties. However, one of the many things that finally becomes of interest in digital twins is not just to make a theoretical prediction of something, but really compare this to experiment. And one of the very critical things that we have seen is that the experiments usually do not very much relate to what you're computing from an ab initio simulation. So what you're getting usually in experiments is some average values or some parameters that strongly depend on the ab initio parameters, but in a very mixed and nonlinear way. So in the end, what I think you also have to do is to somehow get closer to what you are measuring in experiment with what you're doing. So how do you see the path towards that one?
Yeah, great. Yeah, great, great question. And difficult to answer. But basically, at this point, the first thing we could do, since we have this MALA framework, is to do this multi-scale modeling in a serial fashion, right? So you take output from a more accurate method and pipe it into the higher level method. And for now, the obvious choice is to connect here this MALA framework with molecular dynamics. So in the very standard way, right, you use DFT itself and connect it to molecular dynamics. But then you can only run a DFT on these very small scales. And even the machine learning molecular dynamics intertonic potentials rely on DFT data on very small samples of systems, small atomic snapshots. What we, however, could do here is we could generate much larger samples, not just samples, but even bigger systems that can serve as training data that we can then use to train interatomic potentials and then train molecular dynamics or run molecular dynamics simulations. So basically, we can train new interatomic potentials on much bigger scales that don't exist at this point. And with that, we hope to capture longer range correlations in the data. So that's, I would say, the first route we can try.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Attila. Oh, we have another question. Yes, we still have 5 minutes. So, Omar, Abil, please go ahead.
Thank you, Attila, for this interesting talk. I had one question more specifically on the neural networks that are produced after this training. So how robust are they with respect to the different properties of the materials that they're supposed to be surrogates for? So one worry could be that you have to actually retrain these networks quite often whenever you change something on the properties on some of the meta parameters. So can you maybe comment on that? Is that an issue, or are those networks actually quite generic? Once you have one, you can do a lot of experiments with that.
Let me clarify this point. So basically we focus on, or our philosophy is that we at this point is to generate a neural network representation of a given material. So we don't, so the network we train is only applicable to a given material, but it's applicable to that material under different conditions. So the generalization the network has to perform is in temperature space and pressure range. But of course, if you now, here is, it's a model on aluminum. If you use this model and use it on a different material, it might not work. However, we've actually done some experiments along these lines. We've taken the network we've trained on aluminum and used it on beryllium under a pressure temperature ranges, and actually turned out it worked equally well. So I would say, I don't think this is systematic. It might be systematic, but I wouldn't trust. So in general, our purpose is not to generate or construct general purpose machine learning models that will then work for any type of material or even mixtures, but specific ones. And the generalization that is difficult is the temperature and pressure ranges. That's what we plan to do. And along these lines, what I haven't presented today is our automated workflows. So in the end, actually, we'd like to have an automated workflow that does all of that, that generates the training data, does the network architecture search, and trains the models and performs validation. That's where we want to go.
Cool. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Attila Cangi, for your really nice talk. And I also thank all the questions we got to this nice talk.